Hello there, everyone. Good evening, and welcome to another of our programs from the Television Dancing Club.
You didn't think Strictly was a new idea, did you? The outfits, the passion, the turns and lifts, and the fun, Strictly Come Dancing is television entertainment that reaches across the generations. And the culmination of the BBC's long-standing love affair with dance.
And I suppose we could do worse than get on with the dancing.
From its very earliest broadcasts, the BBC placed dance centre stage in its mission to educate, inform and entertain. In this programme, we'll uncover an obsession that ran from the loftiest cultural institutions to the humble dance floor. Through iconic performances and nights out on the town.
If you're just dancing, the music's so great and so loud.
We'll be exploring how the BBC did it all, whether it was ballet or ballroom.
We were magnificent.
Dancing like Travolta or doing the twist.
Degrading and disgusting.
And along the way, help the nation perfect its moves.
A one, two, a two, two, a three, two, a four.
We'll get a glimpse into a world filled with glamour and cool. Alongside routines that were sexy or a little bit naff. Marjorie was fighting a losing battle. Even at the BBC, sex appeared to be taking priority over romance. From teen music programmes like Top of the Pops and The Beat Room emerged the dance troupe.
Come along, baby, whole lot of shit going on.
Dance troupes had been a staple of British entertainment for years, but now the BBC were going to put them centre stage. From the Beat Room came the Beat Girls. The Beat Girls' approach, in various guises, would last for decades. In 1964, one Beat Girl went on to form the Gojos for the newly launched Top of the Pops. Originally, acts like the Gojos were a way of playing records without needing the musicians in the studio, in an age before music videos.
You and me, reflections of the way life used to be.
The dance troupe soon became an attraction of their own. In the late 60s, a member of the Gojos broke away to found their replacement act called Pan's People. Originally an occasional feature on Top of the Pops, they eventually became an act with a dedicated segment all of their own. The choreography wasn't exactly complicated, but it was effective. Teens everywhere could join in and feel part of the gang. Over time, the outfits got skimpier, and 70s camera work wasn't focused on the dancing. Fortunes of formation dancing appeared to be heading in the opposite direction. By the late 60s, ballroom on TV looked a bit tired. By the 70s, it was seen as stuffy and almost eccentric. The same old clichés had been trotted out for 30 years. The obsession with marriage...
They hope to get married in October, which I imagine will mean a little less travelling for Peter, because at the moment he has to travel from Tipton in Staffordshire all the way down to Bristol.
Bored-looking judges.
And your next set of marks for Midlands and West, please. Military two-step mark.
And, of course, the sequined dresses.
The dress is a joint effort. Lynn's mother made it. It's candy pink, by the way. And Lynn decorated it with the white flowers and turquoise and that white boa.
Ballroom TV was considered ripe for parody.
Goodies! Goodies!
The goodies took the conventions of ballroom dancing and mercilessly teased them. But behind the madcap humour, it was a carefully observed critique.
just. How do you do?
Hello.
We are Norma. We are a hair artist.
We are Cyril. We are a bank clerk.
Interesting.
Yes, well, now you've all got to know each other, you'd better run along.
Our ambition is to own our own hairdressing salon.
How interesting. Our ambition is to own our own bank.
Very good. Off you go, girls.
Each sequin was sewn on by hand.
We tied our own bow ties by hand.
All right, girls.
And our dresses were specially made for us by good old mum.
Oh, all right, girls. Run along. Get out.
All right. We'll be waiting for you on the floor. Who's to dance, we mean?
That was a funny joke.
I'm afraid they are extremely stupid, but in this business, that is an advantage.
Yes!
It wasn't just comedy that was turning against the genre. Ballroom dancing competitors were gently condescended to in a documentary that followed a ballroom cruise in 1973.
Number 21 is Bob and Barbara Grover. Presented tonight with a pale green plastic trophy, non-returnable, and a £25 voucher for household goods. But as a thoroughly modern couple, don't they find the rather dated appearance expected of dancers embarrassing?
Ballroom dancing side is old-fashioned. If they changed the dresses, you know, somehow it would lose so much, you know. It is old-fashioned and the tail suits are, you know.
This being the 70s, the questioning inevitably turned salacious.
Husbands and wives don't always make a lovely couple on the floor. Michelle Gandolfi is married but dances with David Bateman, a gas salesman. Her husband stays at home. Doesn't he mind?
Not at all. He knows I enjoy it. He knows I... It's really something I've always wanted to do, and, well, as long as everything else goes all right at home, he's quite happy.
Mm. Do you mind if he went off on a cruise with
Not
the girl?
Not at all. And... I'm trying to make him go away.
The insinuation was obvious.
Isn't it true that dancing is designed to be erotic and therefore tends to bring people together when they dance?
Oh. It's a very difficult question, really. I wouldn't say dancing is erotic. I think it appeals to your senses rather than use erotic. I mean, you haven't got time for anything in the way of sex. You know, there's just absolutely no time at all.
By the early 70s, ballroom was being portrayed as something quaint. But its lack of relevance to the younger generation didn't keep it from the airwaves. If anything, it now seemed a quirky enough idea to get involved in.
Side. So, are we ready for music?
See.
Jolly good. Let's have a go. Into the mood. One, two, three, four. Slow. Slow. A quick, quick. Get ready. Drop. Drop. Quick, quick. Chop. Quick, quick. Slow. Quick, quick. Slow.
We were magnificent. I think I'm almost ready for the championships.
The BBC knew where it was with a good old bit of tango, but usually turned into an embarrassing dad dancer where popular styles were concerned. But in a surprising turn of events as the 70s went on, producers actually caught a style of dance as it was emerging. Focusing on a group of young dancers, one documentary picked up on the early rumblings of a new movement in popular dance coming out of soul music. There were skillful steps and even partnered dances. Just the sort of thing the BBC liked best.
But in the hustle, which is growing in popularity and complexity, there are signs that the boy is prepared to dance with the girl once more.
Then, in 1977, a film was released that took this style of dancing and launched it into the stratosphere. With Saturday Night Fever, John Travolta made Britain go crazy for disco. disco heralded the return of dance moves, with a focus on style and techniques, rather than just expression and doing your own thing. But the stylized and choreographed steps of Travolta's dancing weren't easy to pick up from watching the film. They needed to be learned.
This is the castle at Richmond. It's a ballroom. And it's here that a curious phenomenon is manifesting itself. For the young people who queue to get in 6 nights a week have all caught a mysterious new disease, disco fever. 5, 6, 7, 8.
For the first time since the arrival of the twist, young people went back to dancing lessons in their thousands.
For instance, people go to see Saturday Night Fever, the film, and they pick up bits of the dance routines, but not the whole routine. Whereas we've come along here to dance and learn the dance routines properly, and then we can go to a disco and show everybody what we've learned, where other people are just kind of scraping little bits together and making their own dance routines up, and we can do this, the right thing straight off.
Disco was everywhere. Across all ages, the idea of learning dance was back.
I think we owe a lot to John Travolta for the great upsurge in disco dancing, because certainly in Saturday Night Fever, the stars of the film went along to a dance studio to practice their steps. And I think this is something that the children didn't realise before, that you went to a dance studio to learn disco dancing. They thought you only learn the old-fashioned sort of dancing.
With a sigh of relief, the BBC happily embraced a dance movement that it understood. Order and discipline returned to the dance floor.
Now, figure two are the four hip bumps. So we step onto the left foot, bumping the left hip four times and presenting the hands outwards. Ready? And one and two and three and four. Step onto the right foot, bumping the right hip and presenting the hands outwards, turning to the left. Ready? And one and two and three and four. Now let's rehearse that. And one and two and three and four. And two and two and three and four. And three and two and three and four. And four and two and three and four. Five and two and three and four. And six and two and three and four.
It's highly unlikely a new Travolta emerged from these lessons. Out to harness the rejuvenated enthusiasm and fresh techniques brought by disco was a new dance troupe with a style raunchier than anything on TV before.
There may be things that will make those of you with a nervous disposition tremble a little, but before 8:58 tonight, so what I want you to do now is to kick off your slippers, pour yourself a cup of tea, fix yourself a hot buttered Valium, and off we go with, ladies and gentlemen, Hot Gossip.
The brainchild of Arlene Phillips, Hot Gossip seemed out to shock and inspire with the latest dance styles and fashion, a kind of anti-Pans people. It was a winning formula, and they found fame on their own terms.
You consciously set out to be erotic and provocative?
Not consciously, and in the way that that sort of first happened, I think it had a lot to do with the clothes that we wore, because at the time when the first group was formed, we had no money, therefore we got costumes from whoever would give us them cheaply. One of the boys in the group said, oh, I've got a friend who runs a sex shop, and they have wonderful little plastic dresses and little rubber tops, and, you know, we can have them really cheap. I said, oh, wonderful, let's get all these costumes and we'll do a number in them. And that's how partly the sexy image was formed, and also because we were doing commercial dancing in these clothes where you could see every movement of the body.
Now, you're the Ninette de Valois of this group, if you can call it that. Can you teach anybody to dance?
Well, not always anybody, but I always have a damn good try.
There are basic steps, are there?
Yes, yeah, there are basic steps, which we particularly call hot gossip steps.
And I could, within a millionth of a second, sort of pick one of them up, could I?
Sure.
And you'll lead me gently into that.
I'd lead you very gently. Come on, this way.
Grace Jones, thou shouldst be living at this hour.
Now, Now, you put your left hand on Donna's left shoulder and your right hand just rest it on her bum gently. And Debbie's going to do the same to you. That's it. Now, feet apart. And keep your feet wide apart. Now, relax your knees and bend and then get the hips back. And forward, and back, and forward. Now round, and round, and round, and round, and again. And back, and forward, and back, and forward, and round. Keep going, and seven, and eight.
What fed the fantasy about becoming a dancer, like Hot Gossip, was a new smash hit series from America. Fame's clean-cut kids were a far cry from Arlene's edgy dancers. Based at a school for slightly irritating performing arts students, Fame brought back the dream of becoming a professional dancer to the public imagination. Arlene Phillips was already leading the way.
Since I started Hot Gossip, I've always had letters from kids saying, I want to join Hot Gossip, how do I start, how to begin, do I begin? But now, with Hot Gossip and Fame and Wayne Sleep and everybody else, it's just enormous. Every child wants to dance.
All you needed were the obligatory leg warmers and a leotard, and you were away.
The Pineapple Studios in London are where dedicated young dancers come yearning to be stars, and where stage-struck young hopefuls strive for the chance of auditioning for West End shows. It's also where secretaries turn up in the evenings, leaving a dust of city offices behind them for the glitter, glamour, sweat and dedication of Pineapple.
But soon, a dance arrived from the streets of New York that was to provide an antidote to all the glamour, pop socks and choreographed routines. From a different solar system, breakdancing wasn't a dance you learned in a studio, but outside with your friends. Improvised, spontaneous and edgy, it was an acrobatic dance that not everyone could do. In time-honoured fashion, this was popular dance that whooshed over the BBC's head.
So, from everyone in the dancing club, I'd like to say cheerio and good night to you all as they all come on the floor to shake, twist or hitchhike, and here it comes.